This is the second YouTube video I've ever filmed. I might post this one before the first one I've ever filmed, but this is the second one I've filmed. My name is Jack Pollock. I'm a videographer based out of Draper, Utah. And for those of you who don't know me, unless you're my six friends watching this, in that case, thank you for watching. I'm a videographer for my high school. I'm a senior in high school right now. I do primarily sports videography. I've done a couple other things, and I do a couple other things, but just time of the year and where I'm at right now, I primarily do sports videography. And I've gotten a lot of questions on a lot of my edits before, so I figured I would take this opportunity to do a breakdown of my edits. This is a basketball edit, and I did a couple different things with it that I think you guys would find pretty interesting, so go ahead and take a look.
The big game tonight, Region 4 Championship on the line. The number 4 ranked Corner Canyon Chargers will tangle with the number 3 ranked Pleasant Grove Vikings. Chargers with back-to-back triples have taken the lead back. The Chargers win the basketball game 57-56. The crowd goes absolutely nuts, and Corner Canyon is the region champion.
All right, well, hopefully you guys enjoyed that video. It was super fun to make. So I'm going to talk a little bit about like how I did it, just different things about the video in general, and we can talk about different effects it did and stuff like that. So we'll just go ahead and jump right into it. All right, so we'll go ahead and get started. Here's my timeline right here. Definitely a little intense. I did a lot of audio design. So we're gonna start, we'll work our way down. So for what I did for this video is I color graded all the clips really similarly. And so the Sony a7 IV, when you're shooting at 120 frames per second, it only allows you to shoot 4:20 8-bit, which is kind of a bummer, but I've created a custom picture profile for my camera. It's not like I'm not trying to sell you on it or anything, but I created a picture profile for my camera that makes color grading with this kind of footage a lot easier. And I'll put that all down in the description below, and you can try that out and see if you want to use it. And you can use it with any Sony camera that shoots with those picture profiles. So for color grading in particular, this is what let me turn off the color grading so that way you can see what the clips look like without the grade. So this is what that clip looks like with the color grade. Then this is what it looks like after the color grade. So looks pretty cool. I really like the way that it looks. Something kind of cool, I did shoot with a diffusion filter so you can see the lights in the background. The highlights are kind of bloomed, which I really like. And I do pop that a little more, obviously, when you look at the final color grade. I pop those a little more. Then I reintroduce some colors to the skin tones, change the hue of the blue a little bit. So I'm gonna go ahead and just color grade this clip individually so you can see my process and how I do that. So we're gonna open our Lumetri color panel. Then we'll go to curves first. And this is where I start almost all of my color grades, is in curves. So we're gonna create a little S-curve, which for those of you that don't know what an S-curve is, it's basically just turning your general curves panel into an S. And we're just gonna do a light little S curve because I do wanna maintain a lot of that dynamic range that we've already introduced. So that's what it looks like with the S curve done. And then what we do to pop those lights a little bit, it's already raised a little bit with the curves, but to kind of emphasize that, we're gonna raise our highlights a little more. And then if it needs more, we're gonna raise our whites, which I don't think it needs more. And then for the actual color itself, we're gonna go into the creative panel and turn up the saturation a little bit. So as you can see, the footage has been turned into what's called Rec 709, which is just like a standard color profile. Now what we're gonna, this is color correction. Now we're gonna do our color grading, which is actually introducing colors that are different. So we're gonna go back into our curves panel, and then we're gonna focus on these two right here, the hue versus saturation and the hue versus hue. And so for those of you that don't know about color grading, every color is in a hue. And this is just a panel of everything. So this will control the saturation of certain colors in our images, or in our image. So if we like do a line right here, it'll obviously control saturation. And then for hue, it'll actually control the hue of different colors. So if you do that right there, you can see that colors will change. So this is a great way to get creative with colors. So what we're going to do, and we're going to start with this, we're going to go and select all of our blues, because this chord is really blue. So we're going to go and select all of our blues, and I want these to be a little more teal. So I'll raise that up to the little teal part. So we're going to raise that up a little bit. But as you can see, that's a little too vibrant for my taste. So what we're going to do is we're going to go into the saturation part and go and select that same area. We're going to lower that saturation a little bit. So that way it just is a little more muted. So that way you're more drawn to the skin tones themselves. And I'm actually going to make that a little less teal. Great. That seems just about right. And then we're going to go into the hue versus hue again. And then what we're going to do is we're going to raise these skin tones a little more and make them a little more pink, which I just like that. Makes them look a little more full of color and vibrant. I really like that. And then if you want to, you can raise the saturation a little bit too. And I think that looks about where we were to start. Let's see how close we got. I'm actually curious. Yeah, so pretty close. I did add a little bit of vignetting, I think, which is vignetting is where it makes the corners of the image a little darker. So yeah, that's what I did for the color grade. And as you can see, is I go across all of the clips and reintroduce and add a very similar color grade. So a little more on these adjustment layers. So I did add a grain to my adjustment layer, which it's not super noticeable. You might be able to notice it, me turning it on and off there. But for what I did for that grain, so if we go into editing, we can see the effect that I dragged over. I dragged over the noise effect, which you can find that in your effects control panels. So we can just go ahead and go to effects, and then we'll search up noise, and it will show up under noise and grain. So we drag the noise over to our adjustment layer. And then to create that noise, I recommend for the percentage, the amount of noise, I recommend anywhere between 7 and 15%, just depending on how intense you want the effect. And you can actually, here, let's drag this up all the way. So that's what it looks like when it's in a lot. And that's with color noise, when it's actually saturated. So you drag that down to, we're going to go back to our 8%, and then we're going to turn off the color. So that way it just creates something really similar to film grain, like when you shoot on actual film. So that's the grain layer, really like that. And then this other adjustment layer on top, that's just a crop, just to make it more cinematic, even though I hate that word. It's just to kind of narrow the field of view a little bit, which I actually really like it. That's all the adjustment layers. And then for this effect right here with all the comments popping up on screen, So this was actually kind of funny. So what I did with this is I went, as you notice now that it's slowed down, they're actually all really similar comments because I couldn't find a ton. So what I did was I just screenshotted them, airdropped them to my computer, and then cropped them in Photoshop. And then I just added multiple and created what's called a nested sequence, which is basically where you just stack images on top of each other or next to each other. Then you select them all, and then you go here. We can actually try it out right now. So if we go and select all of these, come on. If we go and select all of these and then double click it, you can go to nest, and then that will create an actual sequence. I'm not sure why I didn't nest those other two parts, but that's what a nested sequence looks like. I think something that's really important that we should talk about is when you're making a video, it should flow. Like it should have like a storyline. It should have a beginning and an end. I feel like with sports videos in particular and with highlight reels, It's easy to get bored. Like you can only see a 3-point or a layup so many times without shaking it up. So you need to create a way to get the viewers engaged. And I think a way to do that is to start with the beginning and an end. So like, as you can see in the beginning, like this is just pregame warm-up stuff, cool little things, and then highlights, and at the end it finishes. And a little bit about this beginning sequence. This shot right here, a couple people asked me how I did this shot right here.
The big game tonight,
so it feels like the image is being like there's a lot of movement. What I did was I started close to my, or I started kind of farther back from my subject, and I have a 24 to 70, and I zoomed in all the way, and as I moved closer, I zoomed out. So that creates that kind of like vertigo zoom effect, creates a lot of movement. It's really nice. So yeah, that's what that looks like. I didn't do anything in editing at all. That's just how it looked naturally. So yeah, that's all I really need to talk about in the beginning. There's a bunch of speed ramps. I'm not going to talk about speed ramps because I feel like that's pretty like basic editing. But for anyone who like wants to know what a speed ramp is but not how to do it, you just basically turn on time remapping on your clip. You go to time remapping, click speed, and then you go and you change your pen tool and you create ramps and speed. So I go down to 20% because I shot in 120 frames per second. Yeah, and that's all we really need to talk about the slow-mo. But you can see I do speed ramps in a good majority of my actual highlights, because that will allow you to pick out certain moments and different highlights that you can encourage the viewer to focus on. So yeah, for audio, what I really, like all I really did on audio was I made sure that it was all properly balanced. So I added a lot of crowd background noise. I have a shotgun mic for that to add crowd noise. So that's, yeah, that's pretty much it for audio design. With a couple other things though, I do add basketball dribbling sound effects, because I feel like it adds just, it makes the video more 3D. I know it's already 3D, but it just engages people more when you add different sound effects. So I just went online and found an MP3 converter and found a good sound of a basketball dribbling and just did that. I also do hoop swooshes as well. So like as the ball goes in the hoop, you can hear the hoop swish. That's, as you can see, that's added after the fact. I just highlighted it right there. So yeah, that's for audio design, that's what I do. And just make sure that everything's balanced well. So if you go to your audio tab, you can see the different channels, how they move. And you can see the master on the right side. And I let it get a little yellow, but it's a good idea to stick around -6, and that will keep your audio well balanced. This clip right here, this is like kind of a stop motion effect. Literally all you do is you just change the frames per second of the video. And that's pretty easy. If we go to the effects control panel, yeah, you go to posterize time, that's the effect. Just search posterize time, drag it and click it. Then I did 10 frames per second to make it look like some still pictures. Oh yeah, so this clip right here, I have the announcer, shout out to Rob Gertzen. I have the announcer in the background, and then I have the shot, and then the music, and then I mute them. So that mutes, and it's really nice. I like that muting effect a lot. Really like draws the viewer into the actual shot itself. So that's a super easy effect too. You just search low pass, and you click and drag low pass onto your audio. And then I usually just keep it at the standard amount, which is 1,495 hertz. Don't know what that means, but it works. Then if I need to make it louder or anything, I just go into my audio tab and make it louder. So yeah, that's pretty much it for that. You can also do zooming effects. This, luckily, I did this when I was actually in the game, where I zoomed into the ball as it was shooting. If you wanted to create an effect similar to that, where it zooms in, I can show you guys how to do that real quick. So to create that zoom in effect, I do the same thing over here where I zoom in a little bit, just to make the shot a little more dynamic. So how you do that is you just go and you highlight, you hit this little time clicker in the corner next to scale, and then you start where you want the zoom in to start. So this is my keyframe right here. And then you go to where you want it to end, which is my keyframe is right there. And then you zoom in, and then Premiere will just automatically zoom in for you. It'll just complete a smooth sequence for you. So that's kind of cool. If you want to zoom in, you can do different things with that. You can also highlight your position and move it left to right and do like panning shots, things like that, moving up and down. So that's that. And then for this final shot right here, it is the same color grade. So you can see the lights kind of pop a little bit. It is important to isolate good moments in video. In video, things move so fast, especially in sports, things are moving extremely quickly. What you want to do is, it's nice to have 120 frames per second because you can pick moments that you particularly like and you can isolate them. And so that's what I did here with the final shot. I like the water flying in, the ice flying in, the huge celebration afterwards. So, you know, as the water kind of comes in, that's when I want to slow it down. And as our coach, Lunt, as he's throwing it down back in there, I slowed that down as well. So find a moment in videos and isolate it and try your best to emphasize that. And that's all what video is creating a story with the clips you get and isolating things that you can. And then everything else besides that is just fluff, like audio design, color grading, everything besides that, that's just stuff that's icing on the cake. But you need to make a solid foundation with the clips that you have. It's also super important to note that this would not be possible unless I actually know how to effectively use a camera. Like you can edit all you want, but if you don't have your image as good as possible out of your camera, it's game over. It's not gonna be good. So what you want to do is try to get those shots in person. You want to watch a shot without having been edited and be like, that's dope, that's cool. That's the primary goal of what you're looking for here. And for those of you that are interested, I'll probably post a video, or I already have posted a video about the A7 IV, which is the camera that I shoot on. I shoot on a Sony A7 Mark IV, Alpha 7 IV for Sony to sponsor me. Apparently that's what they want it called. Shoot with a Sony Alpha 7 IV and then a Sigma 24-70 art lens. I love that lens so much. And then I use a Moment 10% Cine Bloom filter. So we can actually unscrew that here, see if it makes much of a difference now. It might not, but we can try it. So yeah, it just kind of diffuses those highlights a little bit. I'm not sure if it really makes a difference on here. You can definitely tell in basketball edits. Screw that back on. And then we have a Rode Video Mic Go. I have that mounted on a cold shoe on the right side of the camera because I use a top handle and it won't fit. So I have that mounted on the side, that mic's been fine. Can't really complain about it. Then I also shoot with a small rig cage, Natarail top handle, Blackmagic monitor. Had it on, but it died. So I have my flip out screen, which I hate, by the way, and I'll talk about that. But I think that pretty much does it. Thank you for watching, first and foremost. Number two, if you guys have any questions, like any more in-depth questions, feel free to shoot me a comment or a message if YouTube lets you do that. Feel free to reach out and I'm happy to answer. And if you guys have any video ideas, anything you'd like to see, feel free, same thing, shoot me a comment, shoot me a message, and I'm more than happy to answer. So that being said, thank you guys for watching, and I will see you guys in another video. That was really tacky. I'm not gonna do that. I'm just gonna end it.